Edison had over 1,000 patents to his credit and only one scientific discovery. That one scientific discovery was the Edison effect, which, by force of habit, he patented. But, as he himself said, he didn't have time to continue the experiment. The discovery came about when he was developing the electric lamp, using a thread of carbon made from Japanese bamboo as the filament. Carbon, which is familiar to us as charcoal or as graphite or as diamond, has a peculiarity that when it is heated, it passes into vapor. When, therefore, the filament, shaped like a hairpin, of the Edison lamp was too much heated or overrun, as they say, by too high a voltage, the carbon evaporated and condensed on the inner side of the tube and blackened it. But there was a clear streak, a transparent shadow, in the blackening, in line with one of the legs of the carbon loop of the filament. This showed that the carbon atoms were being shot off from the far leg of the loop and were bypassing the second leg. Edison made a guess at what was happening. He placed a metal plate between the two legs of the loop, connected a platinum wire to it, and led the wire to the outside of the bulb. He then found that if he connected this wire and the lead from the intake terminal to a sensitive detector, a galvanometer that is, he got a definite current flowing. But if he attached a lead from the outlet terminal connected to the leg which was casting the shadow, he got no response. That meant that there was a current flowing in one direction only. That's like traffic down a one-way street. Edison never satisfactorily explained the effect because he was too busy inventing other things. And he, who made such good use of other people's scientific facts, didn't realize the significance of his own. But we do today. Our worldwide communications, our broadcasting systems, our amplifiers, our television, our talkies, all depend on the Edison effect. It is the explanation of the vacuum tube and of the amplifying tube. But the means of Edison's discovery of 1884 was not realized until 1904, when Ambrose Fleming in Britain patented the thermionic valve. Now just notice the word valve. Fleming gave it that name because here was a device which allowed negative electricity to flow from the filament to the tube, but not the other way. It's like the valves in the veins of our bodies, which allow the blood in them to move only toward the heart, or like the valve in the auto tire, which allows the air to go in, but not to come out. By inserting a trap, Fleming found that the effect could be used to rectify and detect radio waves. But it was Lee DeForest, the American, who, by adding the third factor, the grid, completed the invention of the modern radio valve. This is the story of a great and observant mind, for once, missed the point. And it illustrates the essentials of a great discovery. A great discovery depends on three things: the method, the man, and the moment. The method is the observation, followed by the hypothesis or shrewd guess, followed by experiments which test the validity of the guess. The theory, which is the guess now justified by these experiments, and then further tests which keep on confirming the validity of the experiments and the theory. That's the method. The man means someone with a gift of acute observation. The moment is that incident in time, or, as I would call it, the scientific climate, in which a whole lot of circumstances combine to make the discovery possible. And in that order, because if the man doesn't have the method, he will miss the moment. Edison didn't have a scientific training in the sense of schooling. But you don't have to have a license to use the scientific method. It's a system of thought, a habit of mind, and, in Edison's case, largely an intuitive report. He was a self-taught Methodist. He was certainly the man, the gifted individual with the shrewd insight, spotting an idea which others had missed and then following it through. The moment, in the case of the Edison effect, hadn't arrived in his time. It had to wait for J.J. Thomson's discovery of the electron in 1897. Before that, in 1879, Sir William Crookes had shown the existence of cathode rays. Thomson took up their investigation at Cambridge. "I had," he wrote later, "for a long time been convinced that these rays were charged particles, but it was some time before I had any suspicion that they were anything but charged atoms. My first doubts to this being the case were aroused when I measured the deflection of the rays by a magnet. For this was far greater than I could account for by any hypothesis, which seemed at all reasonable if the particles had a mass at all approaching that of the hydrogen atom, which was then the smallest known. This experiment showed that his particles must be only about 1/180/40th of the mass of hydrogen atoms, and that they were traveling with velocities of some 1,500 kilometers a second. He first called them corpuscles, which conveyed the idea that the electricity was not a continuous, intangible something, but the swarming of infinitesimal specks. In fact, he and Rutherford strained them out by passing them through tubes filled with cotton wool, as pips are strained out of raspberry jelly by the jelly bag. With this recognition of the nature of electrons, Fleming, in 1904, had reached the moment when he could explain something which had eluded Edison 20 years before.